истории России было много разных флагов, но именно этот стал для наших моряков почти что святым. И вот сегодня мне выпала честь поднимать Андреевский флаг на корабле, капитаном которого когда-то был Петр I. Да, Петр построил наш флот, но по-настоящему великим его сделал человек, который не проиграл ни одной битвы, который в боях не потерял ни одного корабля и у которого ни один из матросов не был пленен.
Moreover, not only in Russian history, but in the military history of the whole world, he is the only one who has never been beaten in a battle at sea. His name is Fyodor Ushakov. Five large battles befell him. Few people will remember that in all those battles he was outnumbered by his enemies. Nevertheless, he always emerged the victor. And here's the controversial part. Let's be straight here, the art of winning battles is the art of killing. And Ushakov mastered it like nobody else had before him, having violated a great commandment not to kill. However, despite that fact, the church calls him a saint. How can that be? A warrior and a saint at the same time? It is a complex philosophy dilemma. It puzzles many people who have chosen the military profession. How can one be a fair and loyal servant to their motherland and take lives? For an enemy is also a human being. Well then, maybe you'll find the answer in the life of Ushakov.
Да, Федор Ушаков дославится, имя твое, ведь это единственный адмирал в мире, который причислен к лику святых.
Ушаков, the blessed admiral. Well, all dreams come true, and it's time for us to set sail on a grand tour in the footsteps of Ushakov through time and space. Today we'll find ourselves diving in Crimea towards a Turkish ship sunk by Admiral Ushakov. We'll go to France to face another enemy defeated by the Admiral, namely the Navy of the Revolutionary Republic.
Ну и конечно же, мы отправимся на место самой главной победы Федора Федоровича Ушакова сюда, на греческий остров Корфу. И здесь, на Корфу, мы пройдем все тайные подземелья, все каменоломни. Мы изучим эту крепость от и до. Для того, чтобы ответить на главный вопрос, как наши русские войска смогли взять эту цитадель. Ведь прежде крепость острова Корфу считалась неприступной.
We'll test the weapons of days gone by and put to practice novel technologies invented by the Admiral.
Мы попробуем пострелять из пушки, стоя на качелях, имитируя таким образом качку. Неужели Ушаков и в самом деле готовил таким образом артиллеристов?
And finally, we'll set sail on a ship of those days to fathom how complex and dangerous it was to fight an enemy below the sails.
Этим фильмом про великие морские походы великого адмирала Федора Ушакова телеканал «Звезда» продолжает цикл программ «Военная приемка. След в истории».
Combat approved. A mark on history. Moscow, Sheremetyevo Airport. Flight to Corfu. When the Greek airliner learned that we were carrying an icon depicting Saint Ushakov to the island, it led to something that even the clergymen had not expected. Flight attendants from Greece started kissing the icon of the Russian hero. They even let the father into the cockpit. The pilot says, though his craft navigates not maritime seas, but rather aerial seas, he is also a captain. And there's no way he would leave the admiral without a token of respect. And that's how a European state, a NATO member, respects our great warrior. Everyone remembers Suvorov's march across the Alps when the Generalissimo rescued northern Italy from Napoleon's troops. But at the same time, no less important was the liberation expedition led by Ushakov to the south of Italy. And Corfu marks only the first milestone of the endeavor. Just listen to what cities the admiral liberated. Rome, Naples. And don't forget that 8 years before that, Ushakov had smashed the Turks and secured the northern part of the Black Sea for Russia forever. Then all pieces came together and one starts understanding why Ushakov is called Admiral Number One in Russian history.
Место, где мы сейчас находимся, это вход в Керченский пролив. То есть вот там, на горизонте Краснодарский край, здесь у меня под ногами полуостров Крым за спиной, Азовское море, ну а там впереди Черное. И вот именно здесь, всего-навсего в 100 метрах от берега, под водой находится уникальный объект. Корабль, турецкий корабль, подбитый лично Ушаковым, точнее, эскадрой Ушакова.
Это единственный сегодня доступный корабль, потопленный Ушаковым, турецкий корабль, на который возможен доступ, просто,
который можно потрогать
руками.
We're witnessing the divers of the Kerch Diving Club go into the sea. Here she comes, the trophy of Ushakov. Ushakov led his ships into 5 battles, sank scores of ships, and no one of them has survived to this day. But for this hulk, though this carcass will impress no one, it is the only trophy of the admiral that has made it to our days. The scout ship Karlangich, Turkish for swallow. It is 1790, the Strait of Kerch. Turkey is gearing up to return to Crimea, gathering troops. But we have only 33 ships against 54 of Turkey.
Они планировали высадить десант с целью захвата Крыма, который был присоединен в к Российской империи 7 годами ранее, в 1783 году.
А почему именно эту точку они выбрали для высадки десанта?
Это ближайшая точка к турецким владениям. Десант выходил со стороны Анапы.
Back in the day, Anapa belonged to the Turks. And right now, they're setting sail to our Crimea. The way things are, we're outnumbered and facing an enemy who has accumulated years of experience in maritime warfare and is now bringing a landing party with them. We have in our possession the fledgling Black Sea Fleet. And the question we're now facing is how to fight under these circumstances. But let's go to the roots by all means and move to the sail frigate of Peter the Great Standard. Of all ships flying St. Andrew's flag, she resembles the ships of those days most of all. Never mind that Ushakov lived 70 years after Peter the Great. The sail fleet hasn't changed much over the time, like the attire of the sailors.
На первый взгляд, никакой разницы между ушаковской формой и петровской нет, но на самом деле разница это есть, и она в цене, и как следствие в качестве. Ну, во-первых, шляпа. Теперь ее делают из шерсти. Правда, она более функциональная, и зимой ее можно использовать в качестве шапки-ушанки. Дальше китель. Раньше его делали из дорогого английского сукна, пуговицы на нем были металлические, теперь пуговицы деревянные, и шьют этот китель из обычной сермяги, то есть самой дешевой на тот момент шерсти. Вот тут возникает вопрос, а с какой целью экономили? Да дело в том, что при Петре форму выдавали только высококвалифицированным матросам, а при Ушакове одеть и обуть необходимо было всех.
Now that we're in uniform, let's get ourselves up to speed with the ship. All major activities on a sail ship, as it used to be back in the days of Ushakov, and as is now, take place on the deck, where you'll find all the reins of the ship.
Если я срываюсь вот так, дальше что со мной происходит?
Ты повиснешь на этом вот тросе.
А, я повису на этом тросе.
На самостраховке, да.
Можно попробовать? Или да? Лучше не стоит? Так. Вот так?
Только предупреди всех.
Now they'll teach us how to fire.
Стояние вот там напротив стола. засовывание туда рук и так далее. Категорическое табу.
On this voyage aboard the Standard, we learn artillery basics from the captain. He explains that even a conventional shot is a genuine ceremony, where everything has to be done by the book. First in goes the spear.
Которым мы можем вычистить все, что у нас там есть.
Then they switch to a swab to clean the bore. Next thing they prepare is a propellant charge packed in a bag. And they use a ram to drive it inside, top it up with a wad, set fire to it, and only this triggers the shot. Then another one, and yet another one. But these are blanks, and we want to fire live projectiles from a real gun. The way Ushakov used to.
И вот тут возникает вопрос, а чем стрелять? Я нисколько не сомневаюсь, что многие из вас уверены, что в то время из пушки стреляли ядрами, ну или в крайнем случае картечью, а между тем на флоте использовали совсем другие боеприпасы. Вот, например, очень похожую на гантель. Что это такое?
Книппель с жесткой сцепкой.
Книппель с жесткой сцепкой.
And although our instructor on the ground is a certified gunner, even he hasn't fired a bar shot before. Thus, let's begin with a conventional round shot.
Наши артиллеристы уходят на безопасное расстояние. Закрываем уши.
Slow motion video footage captures the ball easily going through the shield, triggering shards and splinters flying in all directions. Similar to fragments of a combat grenade.
Что и требовалось доказать. Само ядро пролетело вот сюда. А занозы вот. Представьте, если бы здесь, на этом месте, находились люди.
But let us make it more complex and fire a canister shell.
Картечь мы засыпаем туда в обычном виде или...
Нет, для картечного заряда делается жестяной стакан, который снизу делается металлическая или деревянная подкладка, и сверху металлическая, и загибается вот такими зубчиками.
When fired, the tin assembly explodes inside the bore, giving way to a storm of metal bits and pieces. Pouring out of the muzzle, they penetrate the skin of our would-be ship as if it were paper, triggering a wave of shards and splinters. And it is a devious question. Who's better off, the one who gets a splinter or the guy ending up in the way of a piece of metal? For back in the day, they didn't have antiseptic drugs. And a piece of wood inside the body infected blood. And sailors died from conventional infections. And the shield we prepared for the test ended up blown into small shards. The same could have happened in Crimea to our fledgling Russian Black Sea fleet. But it is ours who emerged victorious.
Чтобы вы понимали, за 5 часов боя русская эскадра выпустила 28 000 бомб.
28
за 5 часов. Вы понимаете масштабность этого всего сражения?
That's why we so painstakingly went through the basics of the naval artillery. Ushakov understood its role better than anyone else back in those days. And it was he who introduced money bonuses and incentives for gunner snipers. They honed and improved their marksmanship to perfection. And often it is sniper shots fired by gunners that secured a victory for Ushakov. And there is yet another important thing about his approach. Unlike many other commanders of his day, the admiral paid particular attention to measures to protect from such shots.
Как ни странно, защита служил обычный гамак. Что с ним делали?
Его скручивали в скатку и закладывали слоями по бортам. В результате щепа, отлетевшая от борта, застревала в гамаке и тем самым защищала от поражения личный состав.
Although this approach was adopted by everyone, not everyone benefited from it. Take, for example, the second battle of Ushakov at Cape Tendra in the Black Sea, where the Russians were again outnumbered. The Turks wielded 1,400 guns against 800 on Russian ships. But despite this, Ushakov won, and he did it with only 21 personnel killed, while the Turks lost more than 5,000 men. Of course, it speaks volumes to the leadership talent of that admiral. But not only that, when the difference in casualties is counted in thousands, it means only one thing, that in one military, the people are treated as people, and in the other, they're simply cannon fodder.
вчитываешься, настолько у него и тон отличает, настолько с таким как чувством это как-то пожалеть, как уберечь все-все. Это действительно отец был. Отец своим матросом.
Father Benedict is a monk who pinned the life of Fyodor Ushakov. It is him who, on behalf of the Orthodox Church, went to museums, archives, and various repositories, pursuing the only goal to collect proof of the admiral's sainthood.
Ушаков для меня славен не тем, что он самый гениальный флотоводец, или самый там великий, или самый непобедимый. Он выделяется другим, вот этим внутренним каким-то светом.
Father Benedict explains that one starts respecting Ushakov twice as much when you understand the period in which he lived. The 18th century marked the peak of serfdom in Russia, and although those recruited to the military were relieved of their serfdom obligations, they were in fact treated as if they were the lowest class. They were not allowed to eat at the same table. Nobody ever put their life on the line to protect theirs. But Ushakov changed that and started fighting for the lives of every one of his warriors, no matter what background they came from, be it a nobleman or a former slave.
Ни одного человека в плен не сдал, ни одного корабля не потерял. Ну, фантастика, на самом деле.
Father Benedict ended up with scores of such stories, but the synod decided that was not enough to consecrate the admiral.
Надо сказать, что с первого раза синод решение не принял. С первого раза. И так сложилось, что в 2000 году в Мордовию приехал патриарх Алексий. И когда мы обсуждали тему строительства храма, я сказал, что мы будем строить храм в честь Ушакова. Вот. Но есть один вопрос. В прошлом году, вот, в августе, когда синод состоялся, он по голосованию не прошел.
Indeed, on one side of the scale there's a long list of honorable deeds, but on the other side are thousands of deaths, and this list keeps growing with every new battle. But on the other hand, we're talking war here, and every war needs to be won, and the cleverer, the smarter this goal is achieved, the more pain it will cause to the enemy. That's what happened in the war against the Turkish Navy, where Ushakov came up with some deft solutions, which had not been used before him.
Это Воронеж, кто не знает, именно здесь, под Воронежем, когда-то Петр I построил свой первый линейный корабль. И вот теперь именно здесь, в этом, можно сказать, историческом месте, с помощью молодых яхтсменов, с помощью ребят из школы Олимпийского резерва мы продемонстрируем те приемы ведения морского боя, которые подарил русскому флоту
адмирал Федор Федорович Ушаков.
A historian with the Academy of the General Staff, Vladimir Ovchinnikov, explains that back in the day of sea battalions, they used to wage war like this. First, the opposing parties had their fleets come closer to each other. Then they arranged them in lines, and only after that unleashed attack. This linear order was designed by French mathematician Paul Haste. Sounds almost like the Russian GOST standard. Anyway, Ushakov turned out to be the first who decided to abandon the Haste standard. For him, the line wasn't set in stone.
Он, в первую очередь, ориентировался на флагманский корабль противника, потому как устойчивость турецкого флота сохранялась до тех пор, пока в бою находился флагман. Как только флагман был выведен из строя, турецкий флот терял управление и покидал поле боя.
Ну что, удар по воротам! Противник падает! Вот он, меткий выстрел!
And firing on the move just sounds nice. But if only you knew what pain Ushakov had to endure in these moments. The matter is that in his childhood, a disease affected his joints. And now when the ship went turbulent, an unbearable pain coursed through him. And aboard a sail ship, this was almost a permanent condition. But neither waves nor storms, nor pain in his legs, nothing ever stopped the saintly warrior. We've already mentioned that he ended up in the thick of battle. And throughout his service, he never got injured. Looks like it's not only about being lucky.
Не приступал никаким делам, не приступал к делам, разбирать, которых требует принятия там решения, да, не помолившись. То есть, когда он был на берегу, он присутствовал на всех богослужениях литургии. То есть его рабочий день начинался с богослужения.
Interestingly, at home, Ushakov chose to live not by the GOST standards of the day. He didn't try to save money or build an estate. He didn't even get married. The impressive thing about all this is that Ushakov lived an ascetic life, when it was not considered chic in society. Catherine II reigned the country and her days were marked by festivities and profligacy. But it looks like these all missed the attention of the admiral.
Он не вписывался в то время, понимаете? Поэтому его многие не любили, многие ему завидовали, многие его подначивали своих военных. Он был не такой, он был вообще не от мира сего, понимаешь? Вот. При этом был военным, при этом был вот того времени, ну, Потемкин, светлейший Потемкин. Великий, конечно, но это, ну, извините меня, это блудники все были.
But let's get back to our experiment with live fire from a real gun. To imagine the chaos that reigned aboard ships in battle.
А теперь мы берем снаряд, который, ну, наверное, только ради вот таких кораблей был придуман.
Да, это книпель с жесткой сцепкой. Он для того, чтобы рубить такелаж, сносить мачты.
Веревки, канаты мы уже зарядили, можно поджигать.
This bar shot, or knuffle, Dutch for a club, resembles more of a dumbbell. The first thing going inside the gun is a bar shot. We fire it. Then we switch to a chain shot, where iron balls are attached to each other by a chain.
Мы готовы стрелять. Стреляем!
These projectiles were deliberately designed to combat sail ships, to tear down ropes and sails. Rumor has it that Ushakov, with his quick mind, went further than that and took up training his sailors to fire from swing sets to imitate rough seas. But let's try this on ourselves as well. First things first, we'll let you know what recoil is. This will let you really fathom the swing set experiment.
Стреляем вот таким.
Порвал веревку, 800 килограмм выдерживает котел.
Вот эта веревка выдерживает 800 килограмм, она порвана.
Now that we understand the power of the recoil, we'll have this gun set up on a swing set. Frankly, we thought we'd have several takes of this gun firing, but after this one, which we'd originally shot for the opening of today's episode, let's run it again.
Неужели Ушаков и в самом деле готовил образом артиллеристов? Производит впечатление такой выстрел.
Actually, I didn't want to have another take of this. The matter is that when it fires, the gun pushes the swing set backwards and sideways simultaneously. Thus, it's no accident that many experts doubt the historical credibility of this approach. Rumor has it that this moment is a brainchild of cinema experts. That could be, but very often legends reflect the reality better than the truth itself. And nobody can argue that Ushakov trained his gunners so hard that they became the best at sea.
Прикажи сигналом. Преображение атаковать Капудана.
I guess it's as good a proof as it gets. The capture of Kapudania, a Turkish ship carrying the Turkish commander. But we're interested in this example for yet another reason. Since it's in this episode that our hero demonstrated his Christian merciful nature.
Когда, например, значит, разгромил он турецкий флот, и вот флагманский турецкий корабль Капудания, где был, значит, сам Капудан Паша, то есть командующий турецким флотом на этом корабле, и вот единственный корабль, там ощетинившись этими пушками, и вот Ушаков его окружает, подходит ему к нему с флагманским кораблем, да, и готов его громить. Ну все, ну еще не громи, и вдруг тебе поднимают флаг, сдаемся. Все, Ушаков прекращает огонь. Он посылает свои шлюпки, своих матросов, чтобы спасти команду с риском, что сейчас корабль взорвется и погибнут еще наши. Вывозит личный состав вывозит командующего, вот, так сказать, вот, и тут на глазах у всех это попадание взрывается.
To save the enemy, risking your own life. Meanwhile, Ushakov was well aware that the Turks would never do this. Moreover, there was this practice in the Turkish Navy to pay sailors for heads of the enemy. To tell you the truth, the practices and approaches that reigned back in the day of the Navy were far from being humane.
Нельсон, вице-адмирал английский, знаменитый. Великий адмирал? Да великий, конечно. Флотовый великий, да великий. Но он взял Неаполь и устроил там совершенно ненужную, ну, никому и ничему резню. Уничтожил мирных жителей, все. Ушаков так никогда бы не поступил, и не поступал никогда. Вот, то есть и там великий, гениальный флотовый, и здесь гениальный флотовый Ушаков, Нельсон Ушаков, да. Но один христианин, православный причем, действительно, по существу. А другой, прежде всего, воин.
And it was not only the Englishman Nelson. Many leaders did the same back in the day. The Frenchman Napoleon, having captured yet another city and failed to locate enough food to support 4,000 prisoners of war, decided to kill them all only to save food. And what did Ushakov do? He saved Turkish sailors.
Когда они подняли руки свои, да, он тут же забыл, что он главнокомандующий, тут же, так сказать, вспомнил, что он христианин, надо пожалеть, надо спасти.
When Turkey went to war, it counted on getting Crimea. But instead, it ended up without Crimea, without the Taman Peninsula, without the lands, which would later be occupied by Tiraspol and Odessa, and they agreed to sign a peace treaty with us. But 7 years into the future, Europe faced another problem, the French. It was still 13 years to go till the Battle of Borodino and the surrender of Moscow. People in Russia had no idea as to what kind of hell Napoleon troops would unleash on the country. But Europe was already fed up with the actions of the French troops. It groaned and moaned, but when it could not, when England and Austria, both sworn enemies of France, turned to Emperor Paul of Russia for help, he sent Suvorov to Italy. And at this very moment, you wouldn't believe who approached us for help, the Turks. The ripples of the French Revolution had reached them, and they joined the anti-French coalition. They were asking not just for Russia's assistance, but for the assistance of the Russian Navy, commanded by Ushakov, the guy who'd smashed their fleet. And that was a real recognition of power. The autumn of 1798 saw the Russian-Turkish squadron led by Ushakov set sail on its great liberation expedition. And the first and most complex battle they were to face would be in Corfu, Greece.
Ну что, дорогие друзья, случилось то, о чем наша программа мечтала давным-давно. Мы идем на Корфу, идем на полной скорости. Более того, мы идем дорогой Ушакова и идем с теми священнослужителями, которые имеют непосредственное отношение к святому адмиралу.
We deliberately mounted a boat to put ourselves in the shoes of the admiral, for he faced an absolutely different mission, which was to capture a city. By no means was it a conventional naval battle. There were other laws and regulations, and that is where Ushakov's experience ran out. Moreover, the admiral was well aware that nobody had ever attempted to attack Corfu from sea before. It was nature itself that helped the builders. These cliffs, nestling two huge bastions, are connected to each other by underground tunnels, with forts sitting on top of them. And don't forget quarry tunnels and mazes. It is not a fortress, but a labyrinth, rather.
Если вы когда-нибудь увидели стены Московского Кремля, то вы поймете, что московские, кремлевские стены, они раза в два ниже вот этих огромных вертикальных укосов.
But that wasn't all. If we have a look at the place from the top, we'll see that Ushakov needed to seize not a single fort, but several, two fortresses in Corfu. We've already described them. And there was another line of defense on the island of Vida. Naturally, there were ships defending approaches to the islands.
А теперь, что называется, добро пожаловать на борт. Вражеский 32-пушечный фрегат «Гермиона» — самое современное судно нашего противника в той войне французов. И хотя конкретно данный корабль «Гермиона» против нас, против россиян, тогда не воевала, но зайти на борт стоит для того, чтобы понять, какой флот противостоял нашему русскому ушаковскому флоту в той войне.
The French Hermione is the largest ship in history which can still sail today. A real giant she is. She carries so much rope that they can stretch 13 miles. Back in her day, the Hermione was like a missile destroyer today. There was no way one could escape from her. Actually, she was designed for this role.
Какой калибр этой пушки?
Это 12-фунтовая пушка. У этой пушки огромная отдача. И часто во время боя они являлись причиной увечья многих членов экипажа, которые вовремя не отошли. Пушка буквально прыгает, она подпрыгивает в воздух.
To pursue enemy ships, and these are the guns on a ship. The fortresses were armed with even more powerful weapons, and every ship attempting to approach the fort risked coming under fire, even before it could reach the shore with its own projectiles. It is February 18th of the Julian calendar, and phase one of the attack on Corfu is in full swing. The attack on Vito, the Russian and Turkish squadron had to attack it first, otherwise they could have ended up under artillery crossfire coming from two French garrisons at once. Like before, Ushakov prayed before he went to battle.
Мало кто знает, что здесь, в Санаксарах, в монастыре просияло сразу два святых с именем Федор Ушаков. Это святой праведный Федор Федорович Ушаков и преподобный старец Федор Санаксарский, дядя будущего адмирала, который всей своей жизнью, всей своей святостью указал племяннику путь к Богу.
Там была внутренняя установка, вот, еще, наверное, с юношеских лет. Вот он полюбил монашество. Полюбил монашество, вот, но избран был Богом на военное служение.
This time as well, while preparing to attack Corfu, Ushakov understood that he was going to war, not so much against the French, but rather godless people. For the revolutionaries denied the people of the islands not only their freedom, but belief as well. When they started forcing them on godless principles and values, driving people out of temples, and Russian sailors couldn't help but feel outraged at what was happening. Driven by righteous anger, they unleashed an attack on the enemy.
Давайте представим еще один знаменитый эпизод. Это штурм с помощью вот таких штурмовых лестниц. То же самое было и перед штурмом Корфу. До этого эта крепость считалась непобедимой. Давайте ее поставим горизонтально и попробуем поднять.
The reenactor explains that back in those days, they used to have a different type of ladders, which instead of two, featured one vertical beam, to which they attached crossbars. Sure thing, it would be easier to handle a single bar ladder. Far easier.
Равняй. Так, Тим, помогай с той стороны.
Давайте.
Да, ребята, нас уже с вами давным-давно...
Убили.
Убили, если бы это было реальное Корфу с реальным штурмом.
A mere 7 hours into the battle, and the fortress at Vita fell. Then things started happening. The French, sitting in Corfu's fortress as if they were in the theater, watched the attack of the Russians. And having just witnessed how the Russian landing party had captured Vita, they realized that the once considered impregnable walls of Corfu could no longer guarantee their protection, and decided to surrender without putting up a fight. What do you think Ushakov did when he landed on the island? You've got it right. He went to church. And again, we're following in Ushakov's footsteps to the temple, the housing relics of Saint Spyridon of Trimetheus. Even before the assault, Russian sailors were hearing rumors from locals that the French had defiled the relics of the saint. This added to the resolve of our troops to attack the place. And then what happened there was victory. Ushakov went to this temple every Sunday. At his request, the clergy had a procession of the cross, and Admiral took personally part in the removal of the relics. 200 years after Spyridon and Fyodor, both are saints. And he also returned to them their faith. Not only in God, but in human beings. It happened when in front of bewildered islanders, he rescued his yesterday's enemy, the defeated French. And don't forget that Turkish authorities were paying money for the heads of each of them.
Видя то, что убивают пленных, русские офицеры, русские моряки взяли этих своих пленных, только что в них стрелявших, в каре, то есть ощетинились штыками, взяли, окружили их и проводили их до тех пор, пока французы не оказались в безопасности. Один из офицеров, видя, что освобождает деньгами, он платит своими деньгами за голову пленного француза, который уже приготовился к смерти.
То есть наши платили за то, чтобы французов не убивали?
Своими деньгами, своими какими-то драгоценностями, которые носили на себе. Вы представляете?
Выкупали врага своего.
Выкупали своего врага.
The ransomed French were not taken prisoners by Ushakov, the way the Turks did. They let them board their ships and go back home. But under one condition, that they would never fight against Russia again. His victories in Europe became the crown jewel of the military career of the admiral. Upon returning to Russia, he retired and moved to a village in the vicinity of the Sanaksar Monastery, where 200 years later he would be canonized and become a saint. And then people would start building temples to commemorate his name. The very first, the largest, would be blessed by the patriarch himself. And people would start coming here to worship him, among them leaders of the country and great admirals, and of course, rank and file sailors. All those who have ever been at sea, who have navigated around the world on a yacht, who have fought for their lives in a storm, who have suffocated in a submarine, those who have remembered him in their prayers many times. Sailors turn to Ushakov because they believe him. Because of all saints on earth, he is the only one who served in the Navy. Thus, he understands what they are asking for. He will never leave them behind. For that's exactly the principle by which he lived his life. The righteous warrior, Saint Fyodor Ushakov.
Возношение и все сожигаемое.